Good morning to you all. It's a great joy to welcome you all here today to Holy Trinity Church for our Parish Eucharist. I'd like especially to welcome you if you haven't worshipped with us before or you're visiting. It's great to welcome you here on this beautiful May morning. It is good to be here, isn't it? I'm not wishing to dampen that spirit. We do have after this service our annual meeting. I hope you'll be suitably inspired by our worship to want to join us, and we'll go straight across to the parish centre where coffee will be served across there rather than at the back of the church today. We also have today a children's breakout group, so any primary school age children are invited, if you wish, to go with our Children and Families Minister and Emma, our Deacon, into the vestry at the side of the church through the door over there. Parents, you can either send them off and remain here in the nave or go with them as you wish, and then the children will return back before the Eucharistic prayer at the offertory. So let's take a moment now just to become aware of God's Spirit here with us now as we prepare to worship. In a moment, we'll then sing our first hymn.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Please be seated. Today, this seventh Sunday of Easter, is a very special time. It's an in-between time. We celebrated Ascension Day on Thursday, and a week today we shall celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. But today we sort of, if you like, hold a space in preparation for that thanksgiving for the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's a time to wait on the Spirit, to pray for the gifts of the Spirit, the gifts of wisdom and creativity. So as we begin our worship this morning, we're going to just hold a moment of stillness in which to open our hearts to those gifts of the Spirit. And now we join together with the response in our prayer of preparation. As we wait in silence, make us ready for your coming, Spirit. As we listen to your word, make us ready for your coming, Spirit. As we worship you in majesty, make us ready for your coming, Spirit. As we long for your refreshing, make us ready for your coming, Spirit. As we long for your renewing, make us ready for your coming, Spirit. As we long for your empowering,
make us ready.
As we long for your equipping, make us ready for your coming, Spirit.
The Spirit of the Lord fills the world and knows our every word and deed. Let us then open ourselves to the Lord and confess our sins in penitence and faith.
You raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy. You bring pardon and peace to the broken in heart. Christ, have mercy. You make one by your Spirit the torn and divided. Christ, have mercy. May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. We stand to sing the Gloria.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. We beseech you, leave us not comfortless, but send your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to the place where our Saviour Christ is gone before, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. So our children's breakout group will now make their way over to the vestry, and I think someone's going to come and collect the candle as a symbol that we're all still worshipping together as part of the same congregation.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers. Together the crowd numbered about 120 people. He said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. So one of the men who have accompanied us throughout the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabas, who was also known as Eustace, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas turned aside to go to his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus looked up to heaven and prayed, "Father, I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world. And I am coming to you, Holy Father. Protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. There's been a lot of discussion in the news recently about the effect that smartphones are having on children and young people with the easy access to the internet and social online. Sorry, we're having microphone problems. Should we use the stand mic, Bernie? I'll start again. I'm talking about the issues that have been identified about children using smartphones, easy access to the internet, and particularly to social media at a young, impressionable age. One contributor to the debate has been the American social psychologist, Jonathan Haidt, who said this: "There is a God-shaped hole in every human heart. If it doesn't get filled with something noble and elevated, modern society will quickly pump it full of garbage." Any of you who have spent just a few moments scrolling through social media will know what he means. But what should that noble and elevated thing be? Creative goodness is the answer one priest and theologian would give. The late Harry Williams wrote this: "A person exists to be the agent of creative goodness." When we create goodness, he went on to say, we experience resurrection life and bring that life to others too. As we reach again this moment in the year when we pause and take stock at our annual meeting following the service, I've been reflecting on and have been giving thanks for just how much creative goodness we're seeing in this parish at this time. 4 years ago today, this church was locked and empty. Even as the vicar, I was not permitted to enter it for prayer or worship. Those COVID pandemic days feel unreal now, don't they? But that was the reality. This place was just silent and empty. And yet here we are, 4 years on, and we have seen this service grow steadily with many new people joining us, including families and younger adults. We're beginning to run out of space, which is a good challenge to have. If I wanted to give someone evidence of the reality of the resurrection of Jesus, then I would look no further than all of you gathered here in this place, week by week, to worship God and celebrate who Jesus is. In our first reading that we heard from Acts, Peter was facing the challenge of choosing a replacement for Judas. And the role description? Well, Peter put it simply as this: to be a witness to the resurrection of Jesus. When we engage in creative goodness, perhaps by trying new things or seeking to do good to others, then the Holy Spirit is at work in us and we are bearing witness to the resurrection. One exciting example of creative goodness that we've been considering this past year is the appointment of a parish nurse. There are many elderly members of our congregations and others connected to the church, perhaps previously regular worshippers no longer able to get to church due to health issues. A parish nurse is a registered nurse who offers holistic care that encompasses physical, emotional, and importantly, spiritual well-being too. A parish nurse will be able to meet people in their homes and help signpost them to appropriate NHS or other available services that are relevant to their needs. Now, it's important just to note that a parish nurse doesn't deliver medical treatments. They don't do hands-on practical nursing care. We're not trying to do the job of any existing NHS or other service providers in this area, but we want to enhance what's already there. So we're looking to recruit someone part-time initially, but if this works, it's a ministry that could be expanded more widely in our local community. There is, of course, so much need. So we'll be advertising soon, and interviews are due to take place in late June. We hope, if we're successful in appointing someone, they'll begin in the autumn. If you want to find out more about this project, then we're going to hold an open meeting to come and find out and ask questions. And we're yet to set a date for that, but that will be announced. This parish nurse will report to our associate minister as part of their oversight of our pastoral care more generally. Of course, this position is currently vacant following the departure of the Reverend Steve Jarvis last November. We had planned to interview for the post just last week, and despite a number of applicants, sadly, in the end, it wasn't possible to interview any of them. So rather frustratingly, we've had to go back to the advertising process, but we do hope now to interview in the second week in July. So please keep that process in your prayers. And whilst on the subject of people, I'd like to take this opportunity to say a huge thank you to everyone who works so hard to make this parish a place where there is so much creative goodness and resurrection life is so clearly visible. Particularly this morning, I'd like to thank those who have served as church wardens over the past year. Sharon Guise had to give up her role at Christmas because of changing work commitments, but I want to thank her for all she brought to that role as church warden. My thanks to Tim Raystrick, who's continued to serve as warden and, amongst many other things, has been supporting the team at All Saints Church in Luddington, which is part of this parish. Our other two current church wardens are now coming to the end of their tenure. It took me several years to persuade Paul Legoux to become a church warden, but I'm glad I persevered because he has been fantastic in that role. Always willing to get stuck in, he's held together some complex activities such as planning the Christmas walkthrough services. Paul's also acted as our human resources officer, so giving us advice with the hiring and management of paid staff. And I'm pleased he's agreed to continue in that role, even though he's stepping down as warden. Helen Warrilow was understandably reluctant to take up my invitation to stand as warden, as this would mean having to spend an awful lot of time at meetings with her husband, who was also the treasurer. But I think it's worked out okay, and they're still speaking and even sitting next to each other this morning, so that's a promising sign. Helen has proved to be a brilliant warden, putting in the time to make things happen and with a very helpful eye for detail. She nobly picked up the role of parish safeguarding officer recently, and I'm very relieved that she too is prepared to continue with that role, even when she's no longer church warden. So my thanks to all of the wardens. There are too many people to thank by name, of course, across the parish. But there's just one person in addition I'd like to thank this morning, which is Sarah Cushing, our parish administrator. Sarah has decided to leave that role, and so will be stepping down this week. Sarah played a key role in keeping us going through these past years of turbulence through the pandemic. Her expertise and knowledge of how the church functions has been invaluable, and her departure leaves a big gap to fill. So thank you, Sarah, for all you've done in your time in that role. My teenage children are often embarrassed by what they see as the stupidity and incompetence of their father. I suspect that's a familiar scenario to those of you with teenage children. Whether it's not quite cooking the tea properly to their satisfaction or forgetting exactly which after-school club it is that they need picking up from this week, they regularly say to me this, "Oh, Dad, you had just one job." As in, you mucked it up. Well, there is just one job we're supposed to do as Christians, and our scripture readings make it clear today what that is: to go out and to be witnesses to the resurrection. As Jesus puts it in the gospel, as he prays to God the Father, "As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world." We might sometimes muck it up, I know I do, but when we create together something that is good, then that creative goodness makes the resurrection something real and known to others. I don't know about you, but it feels to me like we've now moved on from the disaster recovery stage of the COVID pandemic, thank God, and life feels a bit more like it did back before the pandemic in, say, 2019. It certainly feels as though God is doing something new and exciting in this place. So perhaps we can, after all, offer something noble and elevated for that God-shaped hole in every human heart. Amen. Would you please stand as we declare our faith in the words of the Creed? Let us declare our faith in God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father,
Through him all things were made. For us and our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Would you please kneel or sit for our prayers of intercession?
Our response today when I say, Lord, come to bless us, is, and fill us with your Spirit. Lord, come to bless us, and fill us with your Spirit. Let us pray. In anticipation of the Pentecost, we pray for God to fill us with his Spirit. Generous God, we thank you for the power of your Spirit. We ask that we and all your people may be strengthened to serve you as well as we can, that we may be that witness for your resurrection. Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit. We thank you for the wisdom of your Holy Spirit. We ask you to make us individually and as a church, wise to understand your will, to be open to the prompting of your Spirit. And in the peace of your Holy Spirit, we ask you to keep us confident of your love wherever you call us. We ask your blessings on our APCM this afternoon or later on after the service, as we reflect on our serving over the last year and look forward. And ask your blessing on those standing for office, those who will be serving this community in the year to come. Giving thanks for those who have served and are standing down this year. Lord, come to bless us.
Fill us with your Spirit.
We thank you for the healing of your Holy Spirit. We ask you to bring reconciliation and wholeness where there is division, sickness, and sorrow. Especially at this time of wars, we pray for peace in Ukraine and the Holy Land, but also in the many places that are not so well reported around the world. We pray for those who are sick, and on our prayer list, especially for Michael Curley and Pat Jackson. We pray for those who are bereaved, however recent or however long ago. From our bulletin, we pray for the family of John Bayliss. And at the anniversary of their deaths, for the family and friends of Jennifer Southall, Philip Hart, and Keith Edwards. And in a moment of heart, Lord, we hold up to you those we know who need the touch of your healing Spirit. Lord, Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit. We thank you for the gifts and creative power of your Holy Spirit. We ask you to equip us for the work which you have given us. Help us to be the best that we can be in your service, and to be your agents of creative goodness in this place, so that we may bear the fruit of your Holy Spirit and reveal it in all aspects of our lives, the love of Jesus. Lord, come to bless us. Generous God, you sent your Holy Spirit upon your Messiah at the River Jordan and upon the disciples in the upper room. In your mercy, fill us too with that Spirit. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Do please stand as you are able. As we turn now to the liturgy of the sacraments, so we prepare to share the peace. God has made us one in Christ. He has set his seal upon us, and as a pledge of what is to come, has given the Spirit to dwell in our hearts. Alleluia. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you. Offer one another a sign of Christ's peace. welcome back those who were in the children's breakout group with Emma and Phil. The candle that they took with them is now returned to the altar as we gather together as one community around the Lord's table. So let us pray. Father, by your Holy Spirit, you keep the church in unity and truth. As we break bread together, may we be one with Christ in faith and hope and love, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
We give thanks to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is our great High Priest, who has entered once for all into the heavenly sanctuary, evermore to pour upon your church the grace and comfort of your Holy Spirit. He is the one who has gone before us, who calls us to be united in prayer, as were his disciples in the upper room while they awaited his promised gift, the life-giving Spirit of Pentecost. Therefore, all creation yearns with eager longing as angels and archangels sing the endless hymn of praise. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread. And we thank you for counting us. And we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us pray that we might be open to receive the Spirit as we use the prayer our Saviour taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. We would like to invite each of you to participate in the distribution of Holy Communion, either going to the high altar as directed to receive using the common cup, or if you prefer, with intinction where the bread is dipped into the wine at the font. If you don't wish to receive the bread and wine, do come to one of those stations anyway, and if you keep your hands together to indicate it, we will give you a prayer of blessing instead. Alleluia. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Let us pray together. Eternal God, giver of love and power, your Son, Jesus Christ, has sent us into all the world to preach the gospel of his kingdom. Confirm us in this mission and help us to live the good news we proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I sense that Phil is primed and ready to tell us what the breakout group was up to. Not you yourself. Who's going to tell us? Okay, Teddy, come and tell us what you've been up to. Come and stand here. Great.
Today we've watched a clip from the film Soul and thought about how we could become the people that we were born to be and decorated these hearts and gifts that we have and how we could use those gifts for God.
Thank you, Teddy. That's great. Can we see an example of a heart? If you've got a heart over there, can you hold it up if you've done one? Oh, there's Teddy's. Are you happy to show us yours? Great. Just turn it that way so we can see. Wonderful. That's beautiful. Those flames, the symbol of the Holy Spirit. Good. Thank you so much for sharing that with us, Teddy. And those of you in the corner there as well, yes, it's lovely to see your hearts too. Welcome to those who've come because banns of marriage are being read. It's great to have you with us today. And it's my joy to publish the banns of marriage between Robert Chaplow and Alexandra Berry, known to us as Cat, both of this parish. Also between Joshua Rowland and Stacey Pegg, both of this parish, and between Daniel Kong and Sophie Ballon, both of the parish of St. Michael's Solihull. These are for the second time of asking. If anyone knows any reason in law why these persons may not marry, you are to declare it. And we pray for God's blessing on those couples in these final weeks of preparation before their marriage. So, as I've said a couple of times, it's our annual parochial church meeting, an annual meeting of parishioners takes place immediately after this service, so please go straight across to the parish centre. There's no coffee at the back of church today. Everybody is welcome to attend the annual meeting of parishioners where we will elect our church wardens. Everyone who lives in the parish, that is, can elect, but anyone can attend. You just can't vote if you don't live in the parish. It's getting technical already, isn't it? And then following that, we go straight into the annual parochial church meeting where we will elect our new PCC members. I'm not even going to get into who's eligible to elect those until we get into the meeting. But anyway, everybody is welcome to come. You'll find out a bit more about what we've been doing this past year and plans for the future. So do come and you'll be rewarded with a coffee or a tea or a drink over there. Coming up, we have the choir trip to Hereford Cathedral on the 18th of May, which I know these folks are all looking forward to. And we are arranging transport for those. And so you can join us on the coach trip. And the details of how to do that are in the bulletin, aren't they? I'm looking at Andrew here. Okay, contact Rebecca Mills, our Assistant Director of Music, if you want. It says it on the slide. I should read my slide, shouldn't I? If you want to go on the coach trip, or just contact the parish office. Next, Exit Pursued by a Bard, production on the 25th of May, which is coming up. And the Town Chaplaincy Prayer Walk on Wednesday, the 29th of May. The Town Centre Chaplaincy do a great job ministering to folk in the Town Centre, and we're going to pray around the town on the 29th of May. And then the next social evening that's coming up is our Greek evening on the 22nd of June. Our parish marketing and operations officer, I've got her title wrong, but we all know who I mean. Lola is Greek, and so she is going to make sure that this is a proper Greek evening. We're not doing pretend Greek here, we're doing real Greek. So do join us for that on the 22nd of June. I think that's all the notices today. If you didn't catch those slides, they'll be repeated on the screens after the service, which normally works because we're having coffee here, but we're going over to the hall this week, so that's not quite so helpful. But we are going to keep the slides on the screens during coffee in future weeks as well. Good. Would you please all stand for the blessing? The Lord be with you. May the Spirit, who hovered over the waters when the world was created, breathe into you the life he gives. Amen. May the Spirit, who overshadowed the Virgin when the Eternal Son came among us, make you joyful in the service of the Lord. May the Spirit who set the church on fire upon the day of Pentecost bring the world alive with the love of the risen Christ.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon each one of you and remain with you always.
Amen.
We sing our
waiting expectantly for the promised Holy Spirit. Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.